mention, dental amalgam, we all know, is one of the most commonly used and the oldest restoration we know. Almost for 100 years, it has been in vogue, and since it is a direct filling material and has very favorable properties, and above all, the cost is very low. So it has been the favorite of everyone. All our education is based mostly on the amalgam restorations that we do. Now, what is this amalgam? Amalgam as such is nothing but any alloy which is mixed with mercury. It is called as an amalgam. Dental amalgam is an alloy made by mixing mercury with silver tin alloy, to which varying amount of copper and small amounts of zinc has been added. The history is very long, but there are two persons we must acknowledge. One is the person who introduced amalgam in 1818 and is known as the father of amalgam. And second, the great Dr. G.V. Black in 1895, who gave the standardized formulation for amalgam. This formulation is used even today, and it forms the basis of most of the amalgam that we are using in daily life. Coming to the classification of amalgam, there are six classifications of amalgam. First is based on the number of metals that are present in the alloy. It can be binary, ternary, or quaternary type of alloy. The second is based on the shape of the powdered particles. We have spherical particles, we have lathe cut particles, and we have admixed. That means there is a combination of both spherical and lathe cut. There are some differences when the particle shape is concerned. The lathe cut particles, they are irregular and have inferior properties, and they resist condensation pressure. Whereas spherical alloy, they are manufactured by atomization of the molten alloy, and they use less mercury. But they also have one disadvantage, that it is very difficult to establish a proper proximal contour in this unless it is supported by a good matrix and a wedge. The third classification is based on the copper content of the alloy. We have low copper alloys and high copper alloys. In low copper alloy, we have around 2 to 6% of copper present. Zinc and the fourth classification is the zinc content of the alloy, and it is called as zinc containing alloy or the zinc free alloys. That is when the percentage is less than 0.01%. Fifth is the presence of the noble metals in the alloys. So these noble metals can be palladium or gold. The sixth generation, or the recently added classification, is the generation of the amalgam. This is basically based on the development of how the amalgam alloy developed. So we have right from the basic silver tin alloy to the alloy which has nowadays noble metal alloys. I think soon they will be adding here bonded amalgam restorations also. So far they have not added it. Coming to the composition, composition is a very important aspect of any alloy powder. We are basically, when we talk about an amalgam alloy, we talk about a conventional low copper amalgam alloy. This composition was given by Dr. G.V. Black way back, almost 100 years back, and is still followed. Here the silver content is highest, that is around 68%, and even zinc is added to it by around 2%. But the problem with this type of alloy was that the working time was short, there were many dimensional changes, strength was less, and it had a very high creep. So high copper amalgams were introduced in 1963. As you can see, the copper content was increased in these alloys. Two alloys came in. One was the admixed high copper alloy, and the second was the unicomposition high copper alloy. So if you see the difference between the two, in admixed, it is a blended alloy. That is, there are two parts of the conventional lathe cut and one part of the spherical silver copper eutectic alloy. The copper content here is around 13%. in a single composition alloy, there is only unicomposition. That is, all the particles are spherical and they are made up of silver-copper alloy. And the copper content here is very high, that is 23%. This is important for you to remember, because this will change the setting reaction, or the amalgamation reaction changes according to the constituents. So please remember this. Then, role of the individual components, that is silver. Let us take silver. Since we are talking about silver amalgam, it is silver first. 2/3 of the alloy powder is made up of silver. It gives good strength. It has resistance to tarnish, but it decreases the flow and creep of amalgam. It increases expansion, and to some extent, it does regulate the setting time. The second largest component is tin and contributes to 1/4 of the amalgam alloy. It reduces the expansion and controls the rate of reaction, but one of its most biggest disadvantages is that it forms the gamma 2 phase, which is the weakest phase of the whole system and is responsible for failure of amalgam restorations. Third is copper. Copper gives it hardness and it decreases the flow and increases the setting expansion. Then another important is zinc. Zinc is added because it has a scavenger-like property, and it helps in decreasing the marginal failures, but it causes delayed expansion. Lastly is indium or palladium. These are noble metals which are added to help increase the plasticity and the resistance of the and resistance to deformation. Coming to the amalgam reaction, to be very frank with you, amalgam reaction is very confusing, but I have done my best to get it to a level where you will understand. The first thing is, always remember the initial reaction in all the alloys, whether it is the low copper or the high copper admixed alloy or unicomposition alloy, is same. You have this alloy powder particle and you have mercury. So the mercury attacks the alloy powder, and the silver and the tin particles get into the matrix. Then what happens next is different for all the three alloys. So in low copper conventional alloy, the final reaction we get is as gamma, that is the original particles, the gamma 1, that is the mercury and silver, and gamma 2, that is tin and silver. Here you must see that the unreacted alloy particle, that is the gamma, is the strongest phase. Then you have gamma 1, that is silver and mercury, which is the second strongest phase. And the third, that is tin mercury or the gamma 2 phase, is the weakest and the softest phase. And that is why our amalgam restorations were failing. Then came the admixed alloy. So in the admixed alloy, we know that there were two parts of lathe cut alloy and one part of the atomized particle of high copper alloy. So in this, the reaction remains same. That is, you do get gamma, gamma 1, gamma 2, but the silver copper particles remain there in the reaction. So these unreacted silver particles, then what they do is that the gamma 2 phase that is there, it reacts with, the gamma 2 phase that is there, that reacts with the silver copper alloy, because the tin is known to have more affinity towards copper than it has towards amalgam, and it forms a copper tin phase. Thus, the gamma 2 phase is substantially reduced and you get a stronger alloy in the form of admixed alloy. And the next is the unicomposition alloy, where there is a totally modified reaction. That is, after the initial reaction, directly what happens is that the tin, because of its affinity towards copper, it directly goes and forms a eta molecule, that is copper tin molecule. And this eta molecule completely eliminates the gamma 2 phase that is there. So you have your unreacted particles, you have your gamma 1 phase, which is also very strong, and then the other stronger phase, that is the copper thin phase, is formed here. So that is the advantage of the unicomposition alloy. Coming to the indications, what are the indications of amalgam restorations? You are probably in second years, you have already done your cavity preparations, so you know that all class 1 and class 2 cavities which are moderate to large are restored with amalgam. Also, buccal pit restorations in posterior teeth, we do amalgam restorations. It is also used as a core build-up material, that is when the root canal is done and the tooth is fractured and we need to build up the tooth with a strong material, then we use a core build amalgam as a core build-up material. Then we have the pin-retained restorations, when there are complex large restoration which need to be anchored to the tooth, we put a pin there and we build up the restoration with amalgam. Then you have amalgam as a dye material. Then when in the crown and bridge procedures, when you need to make the dye, you use amalgam. Restorations that have high or heavy occlusal contacts, because it is a material with good strength, we are using this material in those areas also. Lastly, amalgam is also used in endodontics as a retrograde filling material. Any material will have contraindications. It cannot be foolproof. So the major contraindication of amalgam is its color. It is black in color. So in any of the anterior teeth, we cannot use amalgam in any form. Second is the posterior teeth. Sometimes people who have a large smile or laugh out loud or show all their teeth, there are some areas which are prominent in the posterior region also. And here also we cannot put amalgam restoration. When the class 1 and the class 2 cavities are very small, but you can use amalgam there, but there is a lot of salivation. We cannot isolate the cavities properly, especially in some challenged children where we have Down syndrome and all. Those kids, there is a lot of salivation. We cannot isolate the tooth properly, and in such cases, amalgam is contraindicated. In very small class 6 restoration also, amalgam is not used. Advantages are many, but the main I will say it is that it is easy to manipulate. You can do it in one sitting. It has a good compressive strength, and the best part is that the sealing ability of the amalgam restoration increases as the restoration matures. Disadvantage, of course, always there. They are many. The prime ones are anesthetic, as I told you earlier. It does have a habit of discoloring the adjacent tooth structure because of the tarnish and corrosion products. The main problem is mercury toxicity and delayed expansion. Mercury toxicity, it is believed that mercury is leaked from the mercury vapors are leaked from the restoration throughout the life of the restoration, and that might cause problem in the patient.